Hello and welcome to the Ritual Misery Podcast, episode beta 69 for Friday, the 19th of February, 2016. This is a show where two lifelong friends talk about geek stuff, whatever else comes to mind. I'm Amos, and fuck you guys.
And I am your lifelong friend, Kent.
I don't English so well.
Words are hard.
That's awesome.
All right, so yeah, awesome. With us today is an old friend of mine from my last tour in Korea, and luckily we've kept in touch, and I still owe him $80. And so this is Chris Cabano, otherwise known as Cabo Wabo 79, because he's a douche like that.
You know, I actually never forgot that either. I wonder if that power supply is still in that computer. That's what I'm wondering.
You know, I haven't made it down to Kunsan to check out the hooch yet. Like, it's one of my goals, but I'm going to end up doing it after my mid tour because I go on mid tour on Tuesday.
Oh man, I don't know how you've not made it down there.
I
wonder if it's even alive and kicking still.
It's not in the same place. It's in a totally different building. It's in the old taxi stand. Remember the taxis where they would park and they would wash out the puke and shit like that. Across
oh,
from
yeah.
The, yeah.
What?
The,
that's where it's at?
That's the new one, yeah.
Oh.
I know,
so
I know.
It's not even going to be the same.
Which is fucked up because I still have a key to 1419.
Oh, hey, remember, so many stories.
So welcome to a private conversation that you have no idea what's going on.
That's what you're here for, Kent. You're supposed to ground us. What the fuck? Where you been?
Yeah.
So today, today's delay was due mostly because of Kent, although... because it's like aircraft delays. You never, you know, you blame it on whatever didn't get recovered, and Kent being late was the thing that didn't get recovered, so it's your fault.
Well, if you want to get technical, we're actually like 2.5 hours early.
No, because once you put the 2407 in to change the schedule, you're done.
Yeah, but you're in beta still, so...
That's, yeah.
Okay,
that's
well, right, fuck yeah. It. All right, so...
we'll figure it out eventually.
Man, it is good to be on this... Damn podcast. This has just been one of those weeks where, like, there's just so much stupid happening all around me that I'm glad to be on this podcast so that there's no more stupid involved.
Well,
that's good. I had a pretty good week. It's just today fell apart. Today was like the perfect storm of shit. And it didn't happen until just right at the end of the day. I was all set. Everything was ready to go. I was like, hell yeah, it's 4:29. I'm going to do the last little bit of my work, and I'm going to head out the door right at 5 o'clock. 4:30, the phone rang. And I was there for another right about 2 hours.
Congratulations. Did you get overtime?
I'm supposed to. Today's the last day of my pay period, so I already submitted my time card. So we'll see. I don't know. I might just take an hour.
Yeah, why not, right?
Take it next Thursday when I come into town.
Yeah, oh, there you go. Yeah. I'll leave it 4 instead of 5.
Yeah, that way we might be able to get next week's podcast on time.
yeah, we'll see about that.
All right, so Chris, how you been, man?
Yo, I'll tell you what, man. Like, this has been like a great week for me, honestly. I got a new job, or I say new job, new position at work, where I went from managing the flight line stuff to where now I'm, I get chief inspector for QA.
Oh.
And yo, you want to talk about like having no job? I mean, it's like, seriously, like, this is the most stress-free job I've ever had, man. Like, people freak out about like, oh, we gotta write this flash. We gotta do this. I'm like, okay, yeah, cool. We'll get to it. Yeah, no big deal. Whatever. So it's been an easy. I'm just like, yeah. And I took today off. I just like, yeah, hey, I ain't coming in today because I'm gonna go to Pentacon. So
deuces.
There's that. So yeah. So I mean, my week's been great.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Nice. We had a we were doing a pseudo exercise this week, which is to say we were working extended shifts. We had all of our chem gear with us, and well,
fun.
That's
fun times.
That's we didn't we don't I. Mm-hmm.
But nice to hear your clear, concise thoughts on the matter.
Yeah, because I have so many of them. We mopped up for all of about 15 minutes. Which is to
so
say
for
we,
the,
we put
for
our
the
chem
non-
gear. I'm explaining it, dude. Stop like okay. Talking over me to dumb it down for the civilians. Like, shit. So So yeah, we mopped up for about 15 minutes, which is say we put our chem gear on. We had to go to mop 4, which is when we're actually wearing the gas mask and everything else, like full on, like everything, for about 2 minutes of that. And then we stripped down, packed up all of our stuff, and went back to work. So the whole week of anticipation led to 15 minutes of, this is dumb.
Sounds legit.
Yeah, and that was during a roll call. Like, that's...
Oh, that's right. You're in Korea.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's pretty much normal. Normal ops.
Hey, hey Kent, how's that Kim gear and all that stuff going for you? Oh, yeah, that's right. We don't do that no more.
Yeah, fuck that. Yeah. Fuck Kim gear. I haven't even seen that shit in a long time.
I'll
like, almost to the point where I've forgotten about it. So, that's good.
I love nope. So last night I finished my week off by doing community patrol, which isn't town patrol. We were not out in the town patrolling. We were on base patrolling. Like I had to walk around the dorms.
Is it that bad over there?
On base to make sure no one got in trouble. And the only thing we came across was people that were smoking outside the smoke pits. Usually right next to a sign that says no smoking. So my suggestion to the colonel that was running the program last night was just get rid of the fucking signs, because the signs are attracting the smokers. You get rid of the signs and nobody would be smoking outside the areas.
Yeah. We had rape patrol at Kunsan when I was there.
That's essentially what it is. Like it's
what?
Yeah.
I don't remember what they called it. It wasn't community patrol, but it was something else. It was basically what it was rape patrol. So basically what you did, you paired up. It was a male and a female, and you would look for drunk women that were not with other women.
Sounds
so
like
whether by themselves. Yeah, so like you look for girls that were either by themselves or with a group of guys, and then you rescued them.
Oh wow, that does not even sound.
Yeah.
Wow.
My thing is, you know, we keep adding all these restrictions. So for the people that are just now watching or that we haven't explained it to them previously, here at Osan Air Base in Korea, we have a curfew. Everybody has to be on base no later than 1 o'clock in the morning. Now you can either be on base or in a hotel room or in a residence off base, but you cannot be out wandering the streets. So much so that if you are in a hotel room and you step outside to smoke, you are now in violation of the rules and you can basically get in trouble. And we, in the military, we have, you know, E1, E2, E3, all the way up to E9. And essentially if you're caught outside of curfew hours in areas that you're not supposed to be in, you lose a stripe, you lose a rank. It's kind of like just a foregone conclusion. Like you're going to go from an E6 to an E5 and you know, all the stuff that's incumbent with that. And
that happened to me my first trip there, actually. My first time there, I got a breaking curfew and no wingman, breaking the wing, like no wingman policy thing, which was messed up because I had just got done being in trouble for catching my dorm room on fire. So that didn't go over like well at all. Like that was like the last thing I needed. And I was trying to help. Yeah, I was trying to help someone that lived like, you know how like there's people who live outside Kunsan, like military people live in the, what they call it, Rainbow Village, I think is what it was called.
Mm-hmm.
So
A-Town or, oh.
Well, we were coming back from A-Town.
And okay. Oh, I'm with you. Yeah.
And you know how they got the bus that comes back? You know, like everybody wants to wait for the last bus.
Right.
Yeah. And the drunk bus.
Like, yeah, the drunk bus. Everyone's like packing in to get there, and then the cops will eventually go, "Look, no more." Like you're on the step, and you're like you're squeezing in, so the door will close. And like there's a guy who couldn't get on, and they're like, "Yeah, sorry, dude." And I was like, "Well, he can't go back by himself. I'll get in a cab with him." And I'm just eating like I'm eating my yaki, which is think of it like, I don't know, what's the best way to explain yaki? Just, it's some fried deliciousness is what it is.
It's fried deliciousness. Terrible.
And eating that in the front seat, and then the cab driver, I hear the guy in the back like, hey, Odishi, pull over. And I'm like, yeah, whatever, dude's got to throw up, cool, right? So I'm just eating yaki, man, like, no big deal. And then Odishi, like, pulls off, and I'm like, whoa, what's going on here? And he pulls up to the gate and stops, like, right at the gate. And I'm like, I'm looking, and I see the cops, like, looking at me. Like, they see me in the front seat. And I'm like, Odishi, go downtown. Like, turn around. I can't. I have no wingman. Like, turn around. Now she's like, no, you don't get out. Get out. And I'm like, no. And the cop is just smiling. Like, there's something just smiling. We got him. Like, I get out, you know, right away, arrested right away. And that phone call to my first sergeant, I could hear him on the phone going, you gotta be fucking kidding me. Aaron Cabano again? Blah, blah. And I was like, oh, this is not gonna go good at all. Yeah. They get here I am, still in the military.
So yeah, that shouldn't happen now anyway. So how did your second tour in Korea start?
You want to bring that up, huh? Wow.
Hey, you're amongst friends. You're amongst friends.
It's just you, me, and Diamond Club.
It started out with me throwing a typhoon party. Like, I'm like, yeah, typhoon's coming. That's, why not throw a typhoon party? Everyone there's like, what's a typhoon party? I'm like, you kidding me? Oh, man, like, let's do this. Like, so we get all the beer, everybody, you know, we barbecue out by the old crack houses over there. Tore down now, so I know they're not there. But we have this big party, and then we clean up, we leave, and the 35th guys came over behind us, and they had a party there, didn't clean up. The next morning, the dorm manager sees it, calls the first sergeant, and because Sergeant Cabana wanted to, like, vocalize, he's throwing a typhoon party, he's the only name that's, like, brought up. So there I was for the next month cleaning the dorms, the crack houses, airmen dorms, by myself, and having to go to mandatory PT on Saturdays. Oh, it was, yeah, not great. And then what was it like? Was it the third week I was there? I think it was my third week that I got so tied up. You guys know how it is. Like, whenever, like, you're the only person that can, like, sign off of, like, a lot of red X's and whatever, major discrepancies.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I was bouncing between several jets, and then I started training some other guys on some other stuff. And we'll just say that something may or may not have happened that should have or should not have happened, and I may have been responsible for it. Which resulted into me getting a letter of reprimand, which was the least thing that could have probably happened to me. That was like month one of my second tour there. And I was just like, this is going to be horrible.
And he finished out as an undershirt, which is like
second
person that you want to talk to before the commander, before the big boss. So
I'm that badass. What can I say?
Damn.
And I'm still in the military. Weird.
So for those of you who have heard me talk about Korea my first time around and being a hooch daddy and loving the hell out of the tour and having such a great time and everything else, that guy right there is the one that taught me all that I needed to know about being a hooch daddy. So he's the one that basically handed off the keys to me before I went and opened my big mouth to the wrong wannabe chief and got that shit stripped away. So
that stuff is fun, man. Korea. I mean, we all have Korea stories. We all have them.
Yeah. It's like a deployment story. If you don't have one, you really didn't serve, which is why my wife's so pissed off. She's never been stationed in Korea and never deployed. So she gets for being a reservist. All right. So we actually have things to talk about. Like, we have show notes. We have ideas that we have passed between us to actually mention.
I should probably pull those up.
You know, it's one of those things that we try to do once in a while, you know, this coarse attempt at being a professional podcast.
Yeah. So I want to, oh my God, I had a senior moment, just blanked out there and words just became really difficult. So I want to follow up on last week's show when I was congratulating Travis from the past, sending him a message into the future of congratulations.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I'm following up on that. He did indeed pass his test and earned his black belt in Shotokan karate. So super proud of the dude. I got to be a small part of his ceremony. It's on Facebook. Look it up if you want to see it. I'm so proud of him. And it's, I don't know, man. It's awesome. He's really inspiring. I was really happy to be there. So again, Travis, good job. Congratulations.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're like Noche Damas for telling the future.
Jesus. Like, did you write these down ahead of time?
No, man. Not at all. I told you, hey, you're not going to stop the stupidity at all. It
oh, happens. God. I love it. I love it. No Jay Thomas. Okay. I'll right. own that one.
Now, Chris, have you seen Deadpool?
Oh, my gosh. No, I have not seen Deadpool. Yes, I've seen. Who's not seen Deadpool?
Apparently, a lot of people. So, if anybody's in the chat room and doesn't really get spoiled by it, tread lightly for the next 5 minutes or so. All right, Kent, I couldn't give you any spoilers last week, but we've all seen it. So, thoughts?
Yeah, amazing. Yeah. Okay. So, I gave high praise to the advertisement campaign, and it's the movie is basically exactly the advertising campaign. It's they're one and the same. It's just a 2-hour version of the advertisements. It's amazing. Something else that I want to point out is that one of the ads was claiming that this movie was a love story.
Mm.
And you're like, okay, it's a fucking Deadpool movie. It's not a love story. No, it very much is a love story. This movie is a 2-hour long, very well written, very well played love story. And I'm not even saying that ironically. I'm very serious. It was
it's the man's notebook is what it is.
Basically,
oh yes!
Yes.
There we go.
Yes.
There we
That's
go.
Exactly correct.
Except Miranda Baccarin is way hotter. Just saying.
Yeah, 100%.
Like
no, I agree with you. I agree with you 100%. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so that's my quick take.
Yeah, I thought it was just an amazing movie. The whole thing, yeah.
What I really loved about it was that just all the little bit of the call outs that he had throughout the movie. There were so many call outs that you're just like, dude, this is awesome. Like I don't want to spoil it too much for anyone, but yo, you know how you saw on Twitter the whole thing between Hugh Jackman and the Deadpool and all that? He was like, they're talking kind of back and forth a little bit. Within the movie, and he's still doing that within the movie, like when they had Hugh Jackman on the cover of People's Magazine,
mm-hmm.
I was like, this is awesome. I loved everything about that movie. I really did.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was 2 hours of me smiling.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I thought I was going to be spoiled last week when Amos brought up about the trailers and all that. I was a little bit worried about going to watch it then, and I was like, oh man, he's gonna ruin this for me, because I got a little scared you're gonna spoil it right then. But then you were right, so all of the trailer stuff was like right there in that first part,
mm-hmm.
and I loved how it stayed in there. It, like, I thought the trailer was just them being the trailer playing to you type yeah. thing.
No, it was actual footage.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I loved it. I loved that part.
Yep. Yeah, yeah, the fact that they put it in, like, you can watch every trailer, well, at least all the trailers that I saw, and all that came to fruition right at the very beginning, and it was just, like, so well done. It was just perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, all right, so was there anything about it, though, that you guys didn't like or wished they would have done?
I would have liked to have seen Wolverine in the movie. I know that's he even made a joke referencing yeah. that we could only afford 2 X-Men. That's why there's only 2
yeah,
of them.
That was funny. I love that. Yeah.
But I would.
It was the two that hadn't been in any other movies or anything yeah. else. Like,
I thought Colossus had been in one of the X-Men movies.
I think Colossus was in. Was it the one where he Deadpool, the Wolverine or whatever it was, when they were bringing up when they had all the mutants. Like the young mutants, and
maybe.
It was Wolverine, because that's when Deadpool originally died. I thought, like, when they killed him off in that one.
Oh, that was in Wolverine. Anyway, the Wolverine.
I don't know.
See, nobody knows about that movie. Like, everybody's like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah,
everyone wrote
the
movie.
But for sure, the other one. What was her name? Negasonic teenage
hothead or something. Yeah,
just some. I don't know. Whatever the fuck it was. Yeah, she definitely has never been in anything else.
Yeah.
No, that shit was funny, though.
I thought they were going to do, like, the whole thing, like, with the comics. Deadpool's girlfriend, Vanessa, was a mutant herself.
Mm.
I thought they were going to go that route, which, I mean, I guess they still can.
They totally could.
Because when Francis had her, Francis could have actually injected her. with that stuff.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Honestly,
yeah.
very well could have. And I'm hoping, because like in the comics, like she's a mutant also. Like I think it's Copycat. I think is what I was reading. So I think that would have been cool. Like that would be like a cool thing to have there. Is like where, like in the next movie, maybe she turned. Maybe I don't know. But yeah, I'm excited for the second one. I'm super excited for the second one.
So apparently Ryan Reynolds was like, he took so much creative control over the whole process, and like the entire ad campaign, like the viral ad campaign, everything else. He was the mastermind behind all that. He was like, this is what we're going to do. We're going to just constantly put stuff out there, and it's going to be this piece. It's going to be this. It's going to be that. And if that's the case, he needs to start doing advertising spiels for more stuff, because it ran perfectly, led up to the movie great. They waited until just after Star Wars to really start hitting it hard and getting into everything, and it was perfect.
Yeah, I read today that there's a petition on, I think it's on change.org or something like that. There's a petition to get Deadpool as the host for Saturday Night Live. Not Ryan Reynolds, Deadpool.
Oh, that would be awesome.
And there's something like 20,000 signatures at this point.
Well, so you'd have Ryan Reynolds in the Deadpool costume playing other characters, like dressed up with and everything else, but still with the mask on.
The whole episode, he would have to be like that.
Oh,
that
my
would
gosh.
Instantly become the most watched episode of Saturday Night Live.
Yeah,
I didn't even watch. Like, I couldn't even watch last week's. Like last week's, I couldn't even watch it.
But how
I
would you
watch this one over and over?
How would you? I mean, because you'd either have to dumb it down for TV to get the TV MA rating, which you know you still can't sure. still can't I mean, curse it, and shit.
Or you could even just do. You could even do TV 14. I mean, it would still work.
Mm-hmm.
No,
because that's probably what SNL is, right? Like probably TV 14.
No,
it's TVMA.
Is it really?
Maybe not. See, this shows how much I watch. Well, I'm in Korea right now. Anyway,
I mean it's on NBC. I don't think they do MA on network television.
I don't know.
I don't know. If somebody in the chat knows what it is, I'm not gonna look it up.
So Colossus was in the Origins X-Men. That's the movie he was in.
The first Wolverine.
Yeah, the original.
Okay, so. Got it.
a buddy of mine texted that to me.
Yeah. Big Boy 420 in the chat room mentions that the skew of the credits. He says the writers were the real heroes, because what would Deadpool be without all the horrible jokes? And if you read the credits and then waited until the very end, even the credits, the opening and the closing credits, were jokes in and of themselves. Like there was, it was completely laced. It was nonstop the entire time.
I think they did a great job keeping the original writers on and through the whole thing. I hope they keep the same writers through the second movie, because absolutely. That's going to make the second movie probably even better. And they're going to have hopefully more money this like for the next one. Maybe get three X-Men, huh?
Right. Yes.
Oh, possibly
big
four.
Goal. Big goal.
And if Wolverine is not the next one, oh my gosh, I'll be mad.
Yeah. No, they're definitely gonna have a bigger budget, because this is the highest grossing rated R movie ever. Well,
for opening weekend, yeah.
I think I just saw it since it opened. It's made $180 million. Like that, it's since it's opened, $180 million for an R-rated movie, dude.
Yeah,
in a 1 week. Yeah, gonna try to watch it again. But I didn't have time this week. I mean, I say I didn't have time, even though I don't really work. But
so I was really excited about watching the Star Wars, the DVD or Blu-ray, whatever, when it comes out, and seeing the extra features, things like that.
Yeah,
I am hoping there is just an amazing behind the scenes package and everything else for this movie. Like I would watch all of it.
Deadpool. Oh yeah. What I want to see is the unrated version, because this movie, it was rated R, but it was like tiptoeing the line of NC-17. I think there's got to be an unrated version, the director's cut, if you will, that they, when they submitted it to the MPAA, they're like, no, this is not going to pass. And they had to trim it down. I haven't read this anywhere, but I believe that they had to.
Yes, the one thing every movie could use, every movie ever could use, is more dick jokes. Just saying.
Oh yeah, more dick jokes, more boobs, more.
He was shot in the butt. I love that part where he got shot.
Oh, what did he say? Right in the. Oh God, what was it?
I don't remember, man. But it was just too funny.
Right up Main Street. I think it's.
Yeah,
what
right up Main Street. Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah. Dude, it was. Yeah. Outstanding. Like, so one thing I saw today about it, because when I was in line waiting over there to get inside the convention center for Pensacon, there's a bunch of us, you know, Deadpool, that's the talk of everything right now. And a couple of guys were talking about for the next movie, and they're like, hey, you know, so they're talking about Cable being in the next Deadpool. Like, who would you think would be a good Deadpool? And I know that there was guys that were talking about, I cannot remember the guy's name, but he was an Avatar. He was the head military guy that had the scar on his face. And I think that's who they were talking about to play Cable.
Mm.
But then someone else said Henry Rollins as a playing Cable.
Ooh.
And I was like, ooh, Henry Rollins would be a good Cable.
You know what? Now that you mentioned Henry Rollins, I think you look a little bit like Henry Rollins.
That's that might be why he has such an affinity for him.
I need more tattoos. Yeah, I mean, like, I don't know. Like, the second movie, I'm really interested to see where they go with the second one and how they go about it. Like, Bob, that guy right there in front of the hideout that he knocked out, he's got to make an appearance again, I would think.
He's got to be in every single Deadpool movie.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So, I know, yeah, Deadpool, I'm watching it again. I just don't know when. As soon as it comes available for pre-order, I'm going to pre-order it. There's only been like a couple movies that I've ever like pre-ordered that I saw came out on iTunes, whatever. The one was The Martian. I don't know if you guys ever saw The Martian.
Yep.
With that, I love that movie. The book, I love the book, and that was probably the only movie that I've ever seen that stayed true to what the book was like. I mean, yeah, they had to cut stuff out, you know, just to make it a movie.
Yeah, I pre-ordered that one. Changes.
And then as soon as this one comes available for pre-order, oh yeah. And it better be unrated. It better have all the extra stuff. It better have all of that. Yeah.
Like, Ryan Reynolds better come to my fucking house in costume and deliver the shit personally. That's what I want. I'll hang out for dinner, you know?
I'll pay it. Yeah. He can insult me all day long. He's Deadpool. I don't care.
Oh yeah.
So my next question, and I think we'll close the Deadpool talk out with this, but you went to Pensacon today.
Yeah.
It was your first convention.
My first con I actually made it to.
So how awesome is it going to be? You know, when Adam Savage goes to conventions and shit like that, and he dresses up in costume and doesn't tell anybody who he is, but he goes and films the whole fucking thing and just goes and meets random people and stuff like that and reveals himself to a couple people, whatever else. How awesome is it going to be when fucking Ryan Reynolds is walking around in a Deadpool costume at fucking Comic-Con, not saying who he is? And everybody's just like, God damn, that's like the best costume ever.
Yeah. Oh, that'll probably happen.
I'm just saying. Yeah. Just throwing that out there. Just, you know, make that happen.
Well, the Deadpools I saw today guaranteed wasn't him.
Did you get the fat Deadpool?
I was gonna say 380 pounds.
Yeah, we had two Deadpools at the SGC that I went to a couple years ago with Ashley, then Dallas, and one of them was like spot on. Looked like it came out of the comic book. Didn't look realistic at all. Looked comic bookish, but it was dead on for the comic book, you know. Mm-hmm. The other one was like this fat dude in this red leotard. You know, that was just like, had black shoulder pads and like a red leotard and like a black cup, like taped to the outside, you know, and it was like, that was his whole costume.
Nailed it. That sounds about right. It sounds good to me. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, nailed it, coach. You know,
there was a guy there. He was wearing a Deadpool, like the nylon mask sort of like thing. And then just a t-shirt. Like of what the costume was supposed to look like.
Mm.
And that was his estate of Deadpool. And I was like, you know what? Good on you, dude. You more than what I did. It was more than what I did. But like,
you went there in a Diamond Club t-shirt.
Like, oh yeah. Hey, I had to represent. I had to represent there with it. But no, for it being my first con to ever go to, I can't lie. Like, the first part of it, I was walking around and I was kind of like, this is not me. Mm. Wow. I thought I was a nerd. I thought I was a geek. I don't know.
Mm.
But the more, But the more I kind of like went around and like saw some more stuff, it was really I really loved like the people that were cosplaying. That was like to me the best part. Mm. Seeing, and oh my gosh, all the underboob was insane. It's like underboob's a thing. It's like underboob is the thing to do now. And I was just like, even guys with guys were doing underboob also. I mean, it was like, hey, not just
yeah, just support equality.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I wasn't judging. I was like, hey man, good underboob. That's good underboob you got going on.
So SGC was the first geek con that I went to, and I went with Ashley, and we had a great time. She went to go meet the game theorist and some other YouTubers that she watches and stuff like that. And I had the same thing. Like, I walked in and I was just, okay, so at the time I was 36 years old. I'm looking around. There's nothing but kids everywhere. And I'm like, oh, this is totally just me being a dad today. Like, this is, I'm going to eat this one for the kids, you know? And we left for the little entrance area where we, you know, well, first of all, they gave us a two-day passes for the price of one-day pass. Just saying, they hooked us up on that. They were like, oh yeah, blah, 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 here you go. So we go up, and as soon as we hit the main hall, the main convention floor, because we're passing all these cosplayers and everything else, I'm like, oh, these are some nice costumes and this and that, and Ashley's totally not into the cosplay. Like, she doesn't give a shit. Like, she saw Pikachu, and she's like, okay, check, I'm done with cosplay. Like, I don't care no more. And we're going up, and we go into the main hall, and there's just nothing but these classic arcade games, like these arcade cabinets, like the, you know, the old style ones, just lined up everywhere.
Yeah, yes.
There's like five lines of people. There's, oh man, there's a whole room with just everything from the original 8-bit Nintendo all the way up through PS3 and Xbox. I'm not sure if PS4 and Xbox One were out at the time, but it was like every generation of fucking console laid out on a table you could just walk up to and just play and just have fun with.
Nice.
And about,
did they have one of these?
They did. They had like had a whole table of Atari stuff. Like it was, yeah, it was insane. But yeah, they once I saw that, I was like, oh, okay, I am home. Donkey Kong.
Hey, yeah. Well, yeah. Pole position, Atari. That was my jam.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, I saw that and I was like, okay, I'm in. We're good. And yeah, of course, my first convention-ish thing ever was South by Southwest in 2010, the BOL meetup, and that was an insane party.
I wish I could go to South by Southwest this year. I was trying to go this year, but I can't get to leave. Because we have everyone testing and all that type of stuff during that time frame that I can't get the lead for. And yeah. See?
Is Austin outside of your area, like where you have to be on leave?
Oh yeah.
Say on a Saturday.
Well, I mean, we don't have that area anymore. That rule's gone.
Oh. Shit, fly. Okay. That rule's gone. Go down to the Okaloosa County fucking airport on Friday night.
hop on a private
fly
plane.
Fly to Atlanta because they make you fly to Atlanta, and then go from Atlanta to Austin Friday night.
Well, doesn't Southwest
and then just leave Sunday.
Fly to Austin? Does Southwest go into Austin?
Yeah, Southwest. Yeah, sure.
Oh, I could go straight to Austin probably then.
See,
I think Southwest flies out of.
See, it's all on you, man.
Probably. Yeah, hook it up, man.
You got me, man. I have no reason. I was actually back in San Antonio for an air show back in October. Yeah, it was the Halloween time. So I took a bunch of my dudes up to Austin to Sixth Street for like the Halloween and all that. And nice. I was like, yo, dudes, like I was like, hey, let's go to the handlebar, let's go here, let's go do that. Like I was showing them all the places, right? And then I didn't realize one of the guys was only 19. And I could not get into anywhere with them.
Oh.
Like, they had one bar. They have one bar there that like under 21 can go into.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, dude, let's go there, I guess. Let's,
18 to chill, 21 to spill.
Oh, man. I felt so creepy. I felt so creepy being in there. Like, I just didn't even like, I was like, look, I'm going to sit up here on like the second floor and just like stay over here. But then I felt like I'm more of a creep now that I'm sitting in a dark area. Watching all this, I'm more of a creep. Never
now,
mind.
Now that I've isolated myself, no one's going to notice me over here.
I know, right? No, but like, I do want to go back. I want to get there for it if I can make it. But
yeah, we'll fucking
but
be
no,
there.
Like, Pentacon, the greatest thing for me there was getting to see Michael Rooker. That was like the coolest thing for me, right? And so I take advantage of, you know, taking the photo opportunity to you know, go see him, get a picture with him and all that, right? Mm-hmm. And yeah, let's just say I got rookered at the photo thing. So I go up there, I'm like, yo, I said, Mike, what's up, man? What's that? You know, hey, Diamond Club, you know, Night Attack, you know. I'm throwing it all out there, and he's like, oh, at first he was like, Night Attack. I was like, yeah, you know, Justin Robert Young, Brian Brushwood, you know, Dragon Con, you've been on the panel and all that. And he's like, oh, yeah, yeah. I was like, hey, can you throw some diamonds? Like, let's get some diamonds, you know. Let's throw up some diamonds for, you know, for the picture. So he's like, oh, yeah, yeah. So we're both posing, and I'm having, like, my celebrity moment. I'm cheesing it up. I'm like, yeah, yeah, get some diamonds going, right? And then he rookered me right before the picture was taken. And I have it right here.
Put it up to the camera for the audio listeners.
For the audio listeners, yeah.
Yeah, you're see this. He rookered me like right when it got, and I was like, got me, rookered.
That is still fucking beautiful.
Yeah. But he was so cool, like afterwards, you know, we kinda laughed and we joked about it, whatever. And then now he was really cool, and we talked about Guardians of the Galaxy 2. Because I made a comment. I was like, hey man, like, you look a lot smaller than like last time I saw you like on TV or whatever. He's like, oh yeah, you know, I'm getting in shape, you know, for Guardians of the Galaxy 2 and all that. And like, I wanted to ask so many more questions, but then you had the photographers there going, yo, come on, let's go. Come on. But he's gonna be there, like, oh, he's gonna be at Pensacon like all weekend. So I'm gonna try to get back in tomorrow when he's in the celebrity autograph area that they have, like, this whole area set off for them. I'm gonna try to get in there so I can talk to him some more. But oh my gosh, like, that was probably the coolest part about it, was when I got down there and I could see like Ted DiBiase. That was like that was cool too. Seeing like, they, tomorrow there's gonna be like a wrestling match. Like, there's supposed to be like some wrestling thing outside in like the parking lot area. And
I was just gonna ask, is it gonna be between just the old guys? Because I looked at the guest list for Pensacon, and it's all these like old school, like Greg the Hammer Valentine and the Million Dollar Man.
So I'm hoping so. They don't say who it's going to be between, but I mean, I'll tell you what, if I'm there and they say, hey, we need like some crowd people, yo, I'm jumping up. I'll run up to that ring. I'll be like, yo, let me get body slammed by, you know, by Ted DiBiase, you know.
Oh, that would be the shit.
Let him pick it out.
I got choked by Chuck Liddell when he came here. And, you know, it was one of those things, like, I was the last one to go into the line because I was like, nah, don't worry about it, you know, blah, 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 blah. And finally my buddy was like, no, you have to, like, he's fucking here, like, go and do it. And you could tell he was kind of like irritated that he, you know, so he fucking throws me in the chokehold. And like, I'm sitting there and I'm like, he's actually squeezing like TikTok, like, I'm, you know, and yeah, they took pictures. And the problem was my buddy was like trying to take the picture, and it took him too long to get to actually get one that I'd be happy with, you know. Because I'm a bit of a photo snob. And so he finally got the picture and let go. And I was like, I was literally seeing stars. It was like 10 seconds. And I was like, do. Okay, well, I'm glad that picture came through. Because, you know, yeah.
Oh, man, yeah.
He's like, his hands are all jacked up and stuff like that. And you can tell that he's not quite 100% upstairs. But he's still funny as hell. And, man, he's strong as fuck. So.
No, but no, I mean, like, I really like. I cannot remember the Samoan brothers that used to wrestle. I cannot remember their name.
Yeah, the Wild Samoans.
Wild Samoans. So they're local here. Like, they're local. They live right here in Pensacola. Yeah. Yeah. I'm hearing one of them is going to be here, or is going to be there tomorrow. That's what I was like. That's kind of the word I got.
Yeah, I think it's Offa. I think he was on the
Offa. That's who it is. Yep, that's exactly who it is. So that's what I don't know. I'm excited. I'm excited to see that tomorrow. Tomorrow's going to be the bigger day. It's supposed to be the bigger day. So hopefully it goes better than what today went for me. Because today, like I said, it was – so the worst part about Pensacon is that you have the convention center, which, think of it like a basketball stadium, a small basketball stadium, okay? So they're trying to do stuff on what they call the second floor, which is basically just the outside edge.
Balcony.
There really is no second floor.
right? Yeah, okay.
Everybody's crammed down on the first floor where the vendors are at. And then, like, on the outside, like, the hallway areas, they have these, like, little small rooms off to the side where they're trying to do, like, some of the panels. And I don't even want to talk about the panels. There was one good panel. The other one was bad. Horrible. but all the other events, like, where, like, some of the celebrities are talking and all that, it's across town. You got to ride a freaking trolley 15 minutes to get there, And then like the trolleys are running like every 15 to 20 minutes, roughly. So that's which is the distance you got to take to go wherever. And I mean, it's ridiculous. That is like stupid. But apparently it's better than what it was last year. Like if people like I was talking to, this is the third year. This is the third year for Pensacon. And it, everyone says it's getting better and getting better, which I really hope so. Because last night when I went to get my my pass to do it for the pre-reg and all that, it took it took some people, they waited in line 2.5 to 3 hours to get their pass because the computers went down, right? They went down to one laptop. And found out the story on that was the second year of Pensacon, they decided, hey, you know, let's go with this program here and do tickets and passes and all that. So they had troubles with it, and you would think that through that year they would work on it. Hey, what's our issues? Let's fix them and, you know, figure them out. No. These assholes go and get a new program. They go get a new program, put it on all these laptops, and guess what happens? It crashes. As soon as the first person to check in, it crashed, like the whole system. They had to call some tech dude that lived right there in Pensacola to go, hey, man, we don't have tech support for this program because it's like past whatever time frame in wherever country where the tech support's probably at. So they get this dude to come in, and it was just, oh, my gosh. I was glad that I got there kind of late. And I didn't have to wait as long as everyone else. But even this morning, like this morning when people were waiting to get through a will call, they were waiting like 3 hours, over 3 hours to get through the line to get passes and stuff still. So they got a lot to work out. They really do have a lot to work out.
Wait 3 hours to get a trolley ticket.
Oh, man, I'm going to be mad. I'm going to be so mad. Because there's a couple places, there's some people I want to listen to. Like Sam Whitworth is it Sam Whitworth?
Sam Whitworth
is he's gonna be talking in one place. Michael Rooker's talking in another place. Denise Crosby.
Yep. Lieutenant Yar from Star Trek.
She's gonna be somewhere else. And I wanna go talk to all these people. Like I wanna go see them. But everyone's like it's a dumb layout. And like the hotel that's right there next to the convention place. You would think they would use the rooms there, like the convention rooms and whatever else there for sure. The panels and celebrities, right? Mm. No. No. They're using them for tabletop gaming.
Wait a second. Is the Air Force running this?
I would think.
Is this services or MWR? Like what?
Oh, my gosh. It's the worst planning, man. It's like some of the worst planning. I mean, yeah, nothing against tabletop games, all right? Let me just say that. Nothing against tabletop games, but... Come on. Keep the celebrities close. Keep them close right there. Keep everyone close in that area. Don't move them across town, you know? But I don't know. But I'm going to go check out some of these tabletop games anyways tomorrow. So I'm going to see what that's about.
Yeah. Oh, but, man. So
that's my Pensacon.
I'd never heard of Pensacon until like 2 days ago. And when I pulled up the website, I was like, holy shit. There's like everybody and their brother in the sci-fi world. Like even Jay from Jay and Silent Bob is there. And like half of the Mallrats cast is going to be there.
Oh, Joey Lauren? Oh, my gosh. Wow, she is just amazing still. Beautiful. Claudia Wells from Back to the Future. She was Marty McFly's girlfriend, right? Mm-hmm.
Yes, yes. Yep. Awesome. Yeah,
I was, oh my gosh, but Joey Lauren. Woo! Oh, man, she looks amazing still. Like, amazing.
Yeah.
Jeremy London was there. Jason Mewes was there. Jason Mewes and Michael Rooker were like the two biggest like celebrities there for everyone. Like they had people waiting in the hallway in the celebrity autograph area. They had like special places for those two for everyone to line up to go and like to get autographs from those guys.
Yeah,
Everyone else, you know, you just kind of walk around the little room and whatnot, go up their tables and talk to them, whatever. But like for both of them, they were the only ones who had like big long lines, like waiting for like people just to talk to them. And I was like, yeah, you know, I'll get in that line. But then I saw like it was like $50 like for an autograph. And I was like, nope.
That's how they have to make their money when they're not.
Not this guy.
Yeah.
You know, I it's cool. I mean, it's cool that they charge, you know, like for signatures and stuff like that, maybe, and pictures and whatever. I'm not against that. I'm not against it. but I don't have that money just to go and just yeah. like pay everyone for a signature. I ain't got it. I'll catch him out on the floor, vendor floor, hopefully. Because yeah. Michael Rooker was out. He was the only one I saw on the vendor floor walking around and like doing selfies with people. I just didn't get to him in time when he left because I was going to try to get another picture with him. But he was the only one that I saw out there on the vendor floor, actually.
Yep.
So, but yeah, I mean, Pensacon, I mean, it seems like it's getting bigger. Apparently, this is Michael Rooker goes to it every year, though. Like, he comes to it every year. Hmm. So he's like the biggest celebrity that keeps coming back, that from what I can gather. So hopefully next year they get closer venues. But I don't know. We'll see though. But yeah. it's not bad.
So I am anxious to hear your thoughts on this. Oh, okay. So lay it on us. Who is it? What is it? And what are your thoughts?
Okay, so my TED Talk is it is listed as one of the top 20 best. I'm sorry,
worst
TED Talks ever. Right. However, when I saw this, I first saw this TED Talk. I think it was 2011 when it first kind of came out. And I watched this and I was like, this is stupid. There is no way this is true. Right. So I get done watching it and I go and try out this method. I'm not saying what it is on purpose yet. I go and try out this method and I'm amazed. It, no kidding, worked. And then unfortunately from that time forward, anytime I've ever used the restroom since 2011, I think of this stupid freaking video every time, and I shake 11 times.
Now, so is this like how to not leave a wet spot in your underwear? Is that what I'm...
Maybe, you know, it could be like, you know, they say shaking more than once.
You shake it more than 11 times, you're playing with it, right?
You're definitely playing with it. You shake it more than 11 times. Like that's why he says stop at 11. He says stop at 11. You get more than 11, you're definitely playing with it, right? Unfortunately for me, when I get to 3, it's already done.
Like, it's...
I can probably stop. So it is how to dry your hands properly, right? And the guy's talking about
it's how to use one paper towel by Joe Smith.
Yeah. Okay. That's the title of it.
Yep.
And
not an assumed name.
Yeah. He shows how like you get that one paper towel out of those dispensers, and it doesn't matter what dispenser it is or what paper towel it is. Give me those brown ones that come out singly, or like one of those automatic ones, or one of the ones that has like auto feed, I guess you would call it, where you pull it out and then it's like the next one comes right behind it. And I don't know, but he shows you multiple times that you can just dip your hands in, get them wet. You shake them 11 times. 1, 2, 3. And he counts it every time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, 11. Takes it, folds it over. You have to fold it over is the key. And then you dry your hands. Boom, done. I was amazed the first time this happened. And if every time I go, if I use a public restroom somewhere, I'm sitting there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I hate myself. But I'm saving the environment. I don't care what you think. I'm saving the environment.
So this is a bit of an anomaly. Kent and I don't have TED Talks this week, and I think we didn't talk about it. But I think it comes from the same point of view. As soon as we saw, I'm speaking for Kent here, assuming that we're on the same page. As soon as we saw the video that you put in the show notes, I couldn't have another one because. This is actually one of the first TED Talks that I reviewed on this podcast. And Kent and Richard Gunther were making fun of me about how big my hands must be if I can't dry them off with just one paper towel. So I am going to be here thanking you for backing my pick on this video, and that every time I'm in a public restroom, I think of this video as well.
Dude, it seriously changes everything for you. I kid you not. It changes everything for you. When I first started, like, I saw you guys were on here doing the podcast and everything, and you guys talked about doing TED Talks. The first moment you guys said TED Talks, this came in my head. Like, this came to mind. And I was like, I have the perfect TED Talk. And every one of your episodes that I've watched since, I'm like, don't bring it up. Don't bring it up. And then last week, when you brought the shoelaces last week, I was like, oh, so close to, like, to mine. I was like, because it was a toss-up. That was a toss-up for me, the shoelaces or the paper towels. And you said shoelaces last week. Awesome. And I was like, yeah, cool. All right, I got paper towels, so I'm good. I'm still good. I'm going to take it.
So, yeah. See, Kent, it's not just me and my big-ass hands. Like, I'm not the only person that appreciates being able to dry my hands off with just one paper towel in the bathroom.
Richard, if you're watching right now, you need to call in and back me up.
Yeah. So the worst part about it is, like, the only time that it backfired on me was that at one point in time, I was married.
Like, at 2 points in time.
Okay, 2 points in time. I was married. Okay, right. I'm like Ross off Friends. You know, I see a girl, I'm saying, hey, you want to get married? Like, I don't even like date her. I just like, hey, you want to get married?
Yeah, she's like, sure, my name's Jane. You're like, oh, don't fucking matter. Whatever. I'll find out when you fill out the paper.
So I was wearing my ring one time, and I went to do the shake thing, and I shook, and the ring came flying off, and it broke the mirror in this bathroom. And I was like, oh, shit. So I just picked my ring up, I put it back on. You know, I mean, I dried my hands. I mean, I shook 11 times. I went and dried my hands. I walked out quick. I just walked out real quick. Yeah. So from that point, then I knew to take my ring off. Like, from that point there, yeah.
That's, oh, man. That's so
11
awesome.
Times. Any more than 11, you're playing with it, all right? I want you guys to know that.
That is awesome.
11. 11 is key.
Told you I was gonna play it backwards.
Is that what that was?
That's exactly.
Oh, what was that?
This show always innovating. Always innovating.
Yeah, don't ever do that again.
Kent heard devil noises and shit in the TED music.
My ears perked up like.
Yeah. So the master calls. The master calls.
Yeah.
Oh man, it almost came on my nose.
Oh my god.
All right, so I got a couple serious topics left to talk about. So Kent, if you want to go ahead and with the main event that you created over here.
Oh, do we have serious topics?
Well, it's one of those shows where I like to bring up serious topics so you guys can make fun of the advanced thoughts that I have because you're not on my level.
Oh, oh my. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
That's what we do.
Okay. All right. So let me find a scorekeeping method real quick. Okay. So what I did was in my spare time today, because I was bored for a good part of today, and then I had the disaster right before I left. Anyway, that's beside the point. So, all right. So I have my scorekeeping method here. And I have a game for you guys. I developed a game. Yeah. Well, I didn't really develop it. I threw some shit together.
We're totally ready.
All right.
I'm back on Kickstarter right now.
Oh, wait. I don't have a Kickstarter. Fuck.
Well, you do now. Chris just made it for you.
Yes! Yay! I hope I meet the goal.
Let me get there. I set it at $20.
Yeah, $20.
Hopefully we can beat that.
You can deliver a handcrafted game to every individual for just $20 total. Total drive pledge.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, so this is almost like a true or false test. So I'm going to ask each of you in turn, who tweeted it? Donald Trump or Kanye West?
Oh, no way.
Oh, geez. Okay. Okay.
All right. I'm excited. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So, we're going to start with the game.
I'm prepping
so Chris...
right now for this. Okay.
Excellent. All right. So, Chris, we'll start with you. I have never seen a thin person drinking Diet Coke. Who tweeted that? Donald Trump?
Donald Trump. Donald Trump.
You are correct, sir. That was Donald. Amos.
You don't have a dinger noise, man. You should have prepped me.
We need a soundboard. Let me...
Hold on. I've got it. It's going to sound ghetto as shit, but it's coming up.
Welcome to so Kent's Life.
We don't have it for... Yeah. Welcome to a beta podcast. all right. So, Amos... Also, for anyone that has money, they know the first rule is to use other people's money. Was that Donald Trump or Kanye West?
Oh, I know this one.
I'm going to go with the Donald Trump because Kanye didn't have any money.
Oh, man.
You would be wrong.
Ah! That was Kanye.
Yeah, 100%.
Bullshit.
Yeah, but and obviously I don't have my sounds up just yet.
Right.
So, all right.
Because it's a super high quality podcast.
We want to innovate and we will win someday. Trump or Kanye?
Oh.
Man, there's an obvious one there, but I don't know if you can go with it. Like, that's.
I mean, I want to say Trump. Oh, man. Can you please repeat the question?
We want to innovate and we will win someday.
Kanye.
And you are again correct.
Yep.
Oh, yes.
It was the someday. Like Donald Trump would never say someday. He'd be like, we're going to win now.
Well, but I wanted to go with Trump. I really, like, my first instinct was Trump on that one.
All right. So, Amos, this one's for you.
Doubt it.
Sorry, losers and haters, but my IQ is one of the highest. And you all know it. Please don't feel so stupid or insecure. It's not your fault.
Oh, that's totally Kanye.
Wrong again!
Oh, my God! What is wrong?
You are not doing so well, Amos.
Hey, I thought Kanye also, though.
This is the worst game ever. This game is complete all right. Bullshit.
All right, Chris. The doors may be heavier, but I promise you, we will break them. Donald Trump?
Donald Trump on a stump speech or Kanye talking about, you know, black rights or whatever platform he decided to spit on that day.
Wait, which one? Donald Trump or Kanye on that one, too?
Yeah.
I'm going to go with... I'm going to go with Donald Trump.
Oh,
man, I had a... Oh, man.
Yeah, that's your first incorrect. I can't find my...
Oh, man.
I can't find my...
You tricked me with the way you ended that. You tricked me with the way you ended that one. You got me.
See?
You got me.
That's what Kent does.
All right, Amos. Let's see what you got on this one.
All right.
Who said Trump or Kanye? My Twitter has become so powerful that I can actually make my enemies tell the truth.
Oh, I know that one.
My Twitter has become so powerful that I can actually make my enemies tell the truth.
That is word for word.
Hashtag finger in the booty.
I'm gonna go with Trump.
Oh, there it is. There it is. I was trying to throw you off.
I was worried there. I heard the ding and I was like, oh, I can't just hit the wrong button.
I might have. All right, Chris. Yes, I am personally rich and I can buy furs and houses for my family.
Easy. Kanye.
Yes.
Easy. Kanye, easy.
Yeah, and that was just the other day, too.
Yeah.
Is that after his fucking GoFundMe came through?
This is the same time. This was the same time he was doing all that stuff.
Yep.
Idiot.
Yep. Okay, Amos.
Shit.
President Obama, close down the flights from Ebola-infected areas right now. Before it is too late, what the hell is wrong with you?
Oh, that's got to be Trump.
Oh, easy now. Oh, man.
That was Trump. All right, it's a close race now. You guys are almost neck and neck at 2 for Amos and 3 for Chris.
Oh,
but
man.
It is
okay,
Chris's turn.
All right.
Who tweeted it? Donald Trump or Kanye West? I have no interest in working with anyone who is too important or too good or too traditional to take a call at 3 a.m.
I mean, seriously, you're going to give me a hard one? This is like...
Chris is like, fuck you for not rigging this in my favor.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I want to say Trump. Trump is my first answer, but I'm going to go Kanye.
Correct.
Yes. Yes.
All right, now you take a commanding lead. The score
I really wanted to say Trump on that last one.
All right, Amos. At Katy Perry. Katie, what the hell were you thinking when you married loser Russell Brand? There is a guy who has got nothing going. A waste.
Oh, that has to be fucking Kanye, because there's no way Trump would give a shit about Katy Perry.
Negative. Oh!
That was Donald Trump.
Oh, shit, son! I just took a big lead!
I just want everybody to understand that this is Chris's motion for having a big lead.
Hey, I didn't go more than 11 times, okay? That was not more than 11 times.
Safe. All right, Chris. I'd like to address the false stories and noise that have been engineered by the media. Who tweeted it, Donald Trump or Kanye West?
Kanye.
Oh. You are right again.
This is bullshit. This is rigged.
All right, Amos.
I thought Trump.
So Chris's advice is go against whatever you think it's
going
to be.
That's all I've been doing this whole time. Like, I'm going with what I think is the obvious and going opposite of it. I should test. Like, so this is what I should do for testing purposes.
Yeah.
Make rank, you know?
There you go.
All right, Amos. Sorry, there is no star on the stage tonight. Who tweeted it?
Ooh.
Donald Trump or Kanye West? Sorry, there is no star on the stage tonight.
This could be Trump talking about Jeb, talking about Ted, talking about Herman. Well, no, Ben. What was that one lady's name?
I'm going to go Trump.
Brioni?
Yeah, Carly. Yeah.
Carly Fiorina. I'm going to go Trump. Whatever.
Say again?
Trump.
Oh, man, I was trying to throw you off.
You are correct. However, that was our last one.
But it's worth it's worth like 5 points, though, right? What's up?
No, this is not okay. This is not Tom Merritt scoring. So, Chris, you are the winner, and your prize is fourth.
I just wanted to throw that in there.
Yeah, so
that's awesome.
Chris wins 5-3. Yay!
That was a good game. I like that. I like that game. That was good. There's a couple of those that were, honestly, there were some tough ones in there. There really was.
Yep. That was interesting. I'll give you that.
I actually did better than you guys on this game, because I totally plagiarized this fucking game. I did not come up with it. I actually did better than you guys collectively did, because the score was 4-3, so that would be a total of 7. I got 8. Out of 15 questions, correct.
So Kent's gonna come in here, like, blowing his own nuts, like, all over some shit he forced.
That's what he just did.
Hey,
you guys are stupid. I just want you guys to know you're stupid.
How do I mute Kent?
Collectively, you're stupid.
Yeah.
Single-handedly, I'm smarter than you.
it's all a matter of perspective.
It's because you guys are still active duty military.
No.
Yeah, you got more free time than us.
Have you had your douche rinse today? I don't think you have. So
I'm looking forward.
But Kanye's tweets this last week had helped you out on that one.
Yeah, Kanye's. Well, I just.
Yeah, there were a few of those from just this last week. I mean, Kanye. Goddamn.
Kanye can be a talk all of his own. I mean, honestly, this last week is just insane.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. So. All right, so we got a few more things. We are running like really long on time, I think. Yep.
Oh wow.
Well, about an hour. We're actually not doing too bad, considering. We were streaming for a while before Kent even decided to show the fuck up. So.
Well, considering we got like 45 more minutes of the show left.
I don't understand. Anyway, we have limits.
What we got next, Amos? What's next on the docket here?
So we'll get to one that Chris put in there. So Honeywell is developing a virtual reality vehicle.
Yeah.
windshield with DARPA. So give us the skinny on that, man.
Okay, so think of it like, so I subscribe to this whatever Department of Defense news email thing that I get in my emails all the time, right? Mm. And this one like really caught my eye because what they're wanting to do here is they're thinking of a way to put make it safer for operators and also at the same time make it easier for them to recognize the hazards, I guess, in the surrounding area. So typically you'd have a windshield, and that's what you have. And it's very hard to make that glass windshield very armor protective, right? Mm-hmm. For the operators, safe for the operators. So what they're looking at is just enclosing the whole thing completely, and then they'll have screens, which we currently use on like our flight simulators and stuff like that, would be on the inside and would give a virtual world on the inside of that whole the cab for the operator to use, and would be able to pinpoint like targets and stuff like that, like all the stuff that you would see in like video games. They're looking at doing that. Like DARPA is like actually trying to make that be a real thing.
I think that's the really interesting part here is the further along we go, the closer to the video games we get. Like it just blows me away. Like
I think they're meeting in the middle because the video games start getting more realistic and then our real world starts getting more like
virtual
augmented reality or virtual reality.
Yeah.
We're just going to meet in the middle here in a couple years and it's just all going to be the same.
Yeah.
So for me, so what brought this to my like really stood out to me is that I do some volunteer work where I go and yes, I'm allowed within 500 yards of schools. So
only because they haven't caught you
now,
yet.
So I do this volunteer work where I've gone to these schools and like where they do this the STEM program. I don't know if you guys know what STEM is or not. The science, technology, something, mathematics, and something. I don't remember the whole thing.
Yes,
would think the kids are smarter that are in the program than I ever thought about being. To be honest with
you, right, yep.
And
STEM program.
What is like the one thing that the last time that I went and I was talking with some of the kids about planes and you know and whatnot, and I was in the third grade class and I was asking them, I'm like, hey, so what alternative ways can you guys think of that we could use in the future to power planes? And this one kid was like, oh, easy, solar power. We can eventually figure out how to use solar power to create enough energy to create this fusion reaction. I mean, this third grade classroom, all right? And then I was like, cool. Yeah, I mean, we could eventually use solar power to somehow do, like, jet engines. I mean, we probably could, right? And he was just coming up with all these ideas, and these other kids in the class were, like, laughing at him. They're like, oh, ha, whatever, that's a dumb idea. And then I was like, I was like, hey, honestly, that is actually a really good idea. And the reason I say that is because it's kids like him that think outside the box and how to come up with these new ideas and new ways that puts us in the position that we're at today. Like, so currently I work on the F-35. And with the F-35, we have three different variants.
We're sorry.
I know. No, it's a great plane. So there's three variants of the F-35. You have the Air Force, or I'm sorry, Americans, we say the Air Force, Marine, and Navy version, but there's an A, B, and C model. And the B model version of it is one that can do the Harrier takeoff, where it can take off from a sitting position and then go. And I was like, in the past, nobody would have ever thought of this type of stuff. Like when the Wright brothers first came up with flying, they were like, it was like, hey, straight take off and go like this. But it took someone with a crazy idea to everyone else to go, why can't a plane just take off from a sitting position and go that route? So after I told that to these kids, I was like, you know, I said, it takes kids like him to think of that, these alternative ways of powering planes and whatever else. That's what's going to help further us in the future. Him right there. And all the other kids kind of sat back and was like, oh, maybe he's not that crazy. Really, I mean, that's to me when I read that story, I was like, so weird, like thinking about like video games that we played before in the past where they start doing that stuff inside the vehicles. And then here it is coming to real life now, like a real life thing. So that's what made this story interesting to me.
I like any time that we can have some sort of augmented reality and still have protection for the troops out there and things like that. Of course, the first alternative would be to just let the singularity happen so we didn't have any more war. But, you know, since that's not quite an option yet, and I still like my independence, you know, we got to protect the people that are there.
Yes, since we're human, since we're like human beings and we have this unnatural urge, I guess, to like want to be
just beat the shit out of each other.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. Stupid humans. all right.
What was that?
I just got a notification. Usually I mute my watch when we're doing this if I'm even wearing it, and I didn't today. So
okay.
So yeah.
Right on.
There we go.
You're in beta still. It's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's all good.
Well, depending on who you talk to, so is my watch. True. So speaking of Apple, perfect transition there. They came out this week, and the FBI is trying to get them to create some firmware for. So I'm kind of going to walk this through a little bit and then get y'all's thoughts. The FBI got this phone that was used in the terror attacks in Southern California. The FBI wanted Apple to create a firmware update in order to bypass the 80 millisecond timeout loop and to make it so they could crack the password and have unlimited attempts at it so they could brute force into this phone and get the information out of it. Apple released a statement saying this is just bad all around. This is just bad for the industry. It's bad for America. It's bad for the world. Didn't even come along the lines of, you know, if we do this, the terrorists win. It was more like, if we do this, consumers lose, period, dot, end of story. This is a death knell for privacy. And then I just read an article, and now I haven't vetted it. I don't know if it's true or not, but I think it's funny as hell. But there is a possibility that the FBI changed the passcode themselves and now need to get back into the phone.
Yes, I was going to bring that up. I was going to wait for you to finish your thing, and then I was going to bring that up because I just saw that right before we went live on the show.
Yep.
Yeah. And, oh, my God. Let that be the fucking case. Like, oh, it's probably true.
Well, on DTNS this morning for you guys, they were talking about this Apple thing and everything else, and there's some irregularities between what the FBI says, the 6 versus 10 attempts, and what Apple says, whatever else. And in the chat room, I was like, you know, with Tom Merritt, I was like, hey, you know, what if they tried 4 times, they couldn't get it to work, you know? And then, of course, it was my mistake. The way that it was written, I was completely off. But then this comes out like, you know, they actually changed the passcode and can't remember what the fuck it is.
Yeah, that.
So it's not so much the terrorists winning; it's the FBI losing.
When you put this link in the notes, I was glad you put it in there. I really was, because when I first heard this story and read the notes and read the story on it, I was like, "No, this is not a good idea. I do not want the government to have some program written for them that's going to let them backdoor any Apple device that they just so randomly choose to backdoor."
Well, here's my thing about it. Like, honestly, like, okay, I don't want the government in my shit, but honestly, I really don't give a shit if the government's in there. However, if the government has a backdoor, that means every motherfucker on this planet has a backdoor. Yep. That all the hackers, all the bad guys, you know, you guys just get too nosy and too techie or whatever, you can just totally hack into my shit because you feel like it.
Yep.
That's
bullshit.
My problem with
that
it.
Is bullshit. Yeah.
My thing is, Apple can't even keep their fucking phone designs under wraps right now. How are they going to keep this software under wraps?
Yeah, exactly. No, it's just not going to happen. That if they create a hackable phone, it's going to be hacked.
Yep.
All the time. It's going to be a very public hack. It's going to be out there like, hey, everybody, here's how you hack the phone.
This to me is a Pandora's box of mobile phone security. If this happens, mobile phone security is completely gone. There's no point in it anymore.
Yep, it's completely.
I really
bullshit.
Just don't want them to see my. I don't want them to see my porn history of tube socks and lotion.
Your dick pics.
Yeah, I don't want them to see that. I mean, that's
you're not supposed to take selfies while you're doing it.
but it's my phone. It's my phone.
Oh, so so you can do whatever you want.
So
yeah.
It should be legit. No, but I mean, but what you said though, is that as soon as the government has it, you know, other people are going to find a way to get it.
Sure.
There's
absolutely.
There's no way that the government has it to themselves.
Right. If it exists, if it exists, and it's not necessarily that a leak from the government, if it exists, it will be found.
Oh, 100%.
Like, I'm talking like within 48 hours, people will already have YouTube videos on how to do it.
Yeah, because everybody and their brother will be trying to hack the FBI or whatever and everything else, trying to find out where this shit is.
And you know, people are already they're already trying to figure it out. People are they've been trying to figure that out for years, probably with Apple products.
Oh, sure.
And there's in Apple. I mean, honestly, Apple probably has. They probably already have it. They probably maybe do have it because Apple controls stuff like insanely.
I don't think they do because I think it would have been found already if they did.
I think maybe a few people in Apple have it, the knowledge of it. They're just they keep it so. conspiracy theory.
Sure. Yeah. It's alien technology.
They have it. They have it. They just don't acknowledge it, so no one knows about it.
You know? Yep. So speaking of Apple, they might have an announcement next month.
Oh yeah.
And possibly the iPhone 5SC whatever or something, and the iPad Air 3. Those are some of the possibilities, and we've heard next to nothing about either one of these, especially the iPad. Apparently, the only big change between the iPad Air 2 and the iPad Air 3 is that the iPad Air 3 is going to have use of the pencil, or the Apple Pencil. I mean, so,
to you guys, does it not seem like the whole fervor or whatever you want to call it for tablets is kind of dying down?
I think it's actually just the whole mobile market. I think I think we've reached a point where the average person is not using the majority of features available on our mobile devices. So therefore, it just, you know, average Joe picks up an iPhone and it does everything that he needs it to do, or he picks up a Samsung phone and it does everything he needs it to do, and he doesn't have a need to exceed that. And there's enough going on with it that the techies amongst us are satisfied with the stability and the capabilities. So they're not driving it further. And there's really we're at that point where, okay, we've reached the paradigm point. Like, we are at the point now where we have to fundamentally change the way we're using our mobile devices, or they will become completely stagnant. You know, we've reached the extent of the capabilities for the current paradigm that we're using mobile devices under.
Right. Well, the way I see it, I mean, this got me thinking when you put it in the notes specifically about tablets. I mean, what else do we need our tablets to do? I mean, at this point, tablets are a legit device now. Like, they're not like, oh, here's a thing that's basically a beta device that, you know, just buy it now and then we'll make it better. It's what it needs to be now. Well, every new iPad that comes out, let's just talk Apple for the moment and not talk about Galaxy tabs and everything else. Just each iPad that comes out, what is the innovative thing that has happened? Not talking about the iPad Pro, but all of the other ones.
Yep.
What? Oh, it's lighter. It's thinner. It's faster. It's got more memory. Well, fuck yes, it does. Of course it does.
Yes.
Every computer, every phone, every tablet, every anything that comes out is all of those things. It's lighter. It's thinner. It's faster. Yep. More memory, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
So,
what else is there to do until the next innovation, like a hologram display or some shit? Like, what?
Oh,
what,
yeah.
Like, what? There's nothing else to improve on, I think.
You know what this is?
That's the first, two, isn't it?
A first gen or a second gen?
Third gen. This is the first generation with the Retina display.
Okay.
This is my second iPad. Is that the
30-pin one?
The third gen, yeah. I had a second.
Or Lightning?
Oh, no, this is 30-pin.
Oh, yeah. I got one of those, I think. So, no, I have an iPad 2.
I had an iPad 2. And right after I got the iPad 2, they came out with the Retina display. And I was like, okay, so I traded up. Until we just picked up my wife's iPad Air 2, I had zero desired upgrade. Like, there's never been a compelling reason. This has handled everything that I wanted to do. And I'm just now reaching the extent of, okay, well, the processor's showing its age. You know, I still don't use all 64 gigs of space in here. And the fact that you can – you know, with the new graphics processor, whatever else, however Apple wants to justify it, the fact that you can now do dual screen and multitask, actual multitasking on the iPad Air 2, well, the iPad Air, I guess, and later, there's actually a reason for me to want to upgrade, but not a need. And I think that if I was going to upgrade right now, I would just go ahead and go with the iPad Pro.
So for me, okay, I started with the iPad 2. Mm-hmm. Then I moved up. Eventually, I got the iPad Air, and I used it for everything. Like, cause I had for me at the time, the iPhone 5, it was just so small, and like, or the iPhone 4. I mean, they were just small. I didn't like them. I mean, I could do my stuff that I needed to on there, but I used my iPad for like a lot of things, work stuff. I mean, just a lot of things I used my iPad Air or my iPad for. Then I got the iPad Air, loved it, but then I got the iPhone 6 Plus. This thing is just it's. For me, it's the perfect size. I can do everything I need to do on here. So when my MacBook hard drive just crashed last week, I wasn't in a hurry to really get it fixed. And then this is the box I have, right? I still have it in the box. This is my iPad with a new digitizer screen. It's been broke since December, I think. November, it's been broke. And I've had to go back and forth with iFixit. And that's something separate with iFixit, having to go back and forth. They had an issue with the digitizer screens because I broke it. I break all my iPad screens. I'm not going to lie. I learned how to replace them myself. I have learned myself how to replace them. But I've had this phone now for so long that it doesn't even matter to me that I don't have access to this iPad anymore, because I can do everything I need to do on my phone now. That for me, the news about the iPad 3 and that it may come out and have this feature or may have that, like what little bit has been talked about, I don't even care.
Yeah.
I really don't care, because my phone does everything I really need.
Yep.
I have no concern for it. So like, that's why I'm not like, when I was looking and I knew there was an announcement coming, and I looked at the phone for the 5S, was it 5SC or something like that they're calling it?
Hmm.
Something like that.
I was like, whatever, cool. That's Apple. And Apple has to do that. Apple has to try to – I think it was Tom who talked about that Apple has to do something – no, I'm sorry. It was on Mac Break Weekly, possibly, what I was watching, where they were talking about Apple has to do something to keep up with every genre that's out there for people who don't like the bigger phones. There's people who just like the smaller size phone. So Apple's just keeping up to say, hey, cool, all right, we gave you the iPhone 5, whatever C that we gave you last time. Now we're going to give you this one that's going to have fingerprint reader. It's going to have the faster processor. It's going to have this.
Yep.
But it will still be in the 4-inch design that you like and that you enjoy, because they don't want to lose that market of people that will pay money for that.
Mm-hmm.
So that, to me, it's, I don't know. But I don't care anymore. I don't care about the rest of the tablets or what's new for the tablet or what's new coming out there. It's like you said, Kent, like, what's the next innovation? What is the next innovation? You'll have my interest again when you give me like the hologram like iPad that I can like have something that's on my wrist and boom, I have my screen like all right here and I can go.
Right.
Yeah. Cool. There you go.
Exactly. Yep. Yep.
Yeah. So that's going to be interesting, especially with Apple's developer conference this summer and then going into the school year and see what they come up with. And I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm just completely wrong. But I'm at the point now where I just think that there's nothing left in the current paradigm to develop to. We have to fundamentally change the way that our devices are working for us.
Mm-hmm. I would possibly be interested in the iPad Air 3. I think, is it iPad Air 3?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, iPad Air 3. If no, I can't think of anything.
Yeah, there's nothing.
I was really trying to think of something, but no,
like,
I mean,
if I could get a free upgrade, I'd be all about it, because it's lighter, faster, smaller, blah, blah, blah.
But you're on like an iPad mini though, like a first gen iPad mini. Well,
okay. Like a second gen iPad mini, I think is like, what
it's,
I got.
It's not even a Retina one, is it?
I would like a new one if
actually,
I could have
a... The first mini that's Retina.
Okay.
I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would like a new one. I would like a new iPad Air just so I can have the fingerprint reader.
Mm.
Because that's the one thing that makes me mad the most, like when I had this, when I got my phone, and then the iPad Air, because like, you know, you're pressing the home button, you think you're going to open it, and you're like, Oh, I gotta use this stupid password still.
Yes, I do the same thing on my iPad.
I do that with my MacBook Air, my MacBook Pro. Like every time I log, I'm at work and I put my CAC in the little reader, and I'm like, "Where's the thumb scanner?" Because I don't want to fucking have to type in this.
I love the fingerprint reader. I mean, I don't care what anybody says. I've tried the fingerprint readers on the laptops, on the Android phones, or the Android phones, and all that. The one on the Apple phone is by far, to me, the easiest and the best one that I have used at all. The ones where you gotta take your and like swipe your finger down, or just let me slap part of my finger that I've registered on there. Let me get like in my drunken haze of like, I want to drunk text someone. Like, let me get that on there. I mean, if they're gonna change anything, innovate the like their my. You can read my alcohol content to go. You got too much alcohol in you. You're not good. You're not gonna open your phone. I refuse to let you open your phone unless you're calling a taxi. That's all you're gonna. That's all I'm gonna.
That would be awesome, but nobody would buy that. Everybody would be like, "Oh, fuck that! No. I don't want that."
Yeah, because the drunk text. I mean, you can't top it. You can't top those drunk texts. No.
So speaking of just random shit, I was watching DTNS earlier this week, and I was in chat room. And so Aaron Carson was the guest, and I think it was Thursday's show. And I made a comment in the chat room that was not well received in any way, shape, or form. And it said, is it my affinity for tech, or are the women in tech getting so much prettier than the gamer girls that didn't care about their appearance when I was in high school? Allie Gertz, Nicole Spagnuolo, Veronica Belmont, and Aaron Carson. And I'm not trying to be sexist here, but just something that I've noticed. It's awesome, and it's awesome that it's not just movie stars being gorgeous. Probably something I need to work out internally. Frowny face. Now, you two know me well enough to understand my intention behind it was not to be like, "Oh my God, so and so so gorgeous." But
yeah, when I saw that, I was like, "Wow, did he really just say that? Like that?" And I was like, "That's not Amos at all. Like to say it like that." Yeah.
Anyway, my thing is okay. So back in high school, you had geek dudes and geek girls and nerd boys and nerd girls or whatever, and like
you're talking our time back in high school,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Okay. Like, a long time ago.
Yeah, 20 something years ago. So, but it was always. And I don't think that I'm the only person here, but it seemed like the kids that were really geeky, that were you know, self-assured enough to actually express their geekiness, unlike the majority of us, they were the unkempt ones. Not that they were dirty or they didn't bathe, but they just didn't care about their appearance. It was like their outward appearance was completely secondary to everything else that was going on. You know, they might brush their hair in the morning, but then they didn't give a shit if it just went everywhere. The kids weren't like dressing up like, you know, with decent clothes or anything else. They're just like, "Oh, this is a shirt. I'm putting a shirt on." You know,
this one doesn't stink.
Yeah. Yeah, and it was just the overall, and perhaps I'm just being a complete douche here, which is absolutely possible, but it seemed like they didn't really care. But now, because being a geek and being a nerd has become more chic, it's become more mainstream, it's become more accepted, and the audience availability is growing. You have these nerds, and unfortunately, I'm a male and I'm heterosexual, so I'm not really paying attention to the appearance of the dudes. Completely my fault, right? But you have all these gamer girls and all these tech geeks, tech women and everything else. And it's like the stark contrast from the nerd girl that I grew up playing D&D with. And
you just didn't notice it at the time.
It could be. It could very well be. But I'm looking back at my memories and like all the you know, you had like the only geeks that were like that cared about all that and, you know, prettied up or whatever else and played to the aesthetics of the opposite gender were the choir girls.
Yeah, okay. So, all right. Let me go ahead and inject my comments.
No,
here.
By all means, because, okay. You know, I'm
you said
just coasting.
All right, you said you didn't notice the guys or whatever. All right. So back in high school, you're talking about these nerdy girls, and they, you know, didn't care that much about their appearance. We were the fucking nerdy dudes, the geeky fucking dudes. How much fucking effort did we fucking put into our appearance? Zero, or just above zero, right? Yeah. Like, okay, I'm not stinky.
Yeah, it was.
Okay, this is why school was clothes stained.
On. It was dressed and hygienic plus one. That's all it was.
Right, exactly. And that's how you're describing these women. That's okay, same. The males and the females were the same. Today, okay, you can look at the males today and the same thing, because you nailed it when you said that the new chic is to be nerd or geek or whatever, which is, I mean, you could say that that's the hipsters, the counterculture. It's the hipsters. It's the ones wearing the fucking Optimus Prime t-shirt and the fucking, you know, whatever.
I don't care about that. I'm talking about the ones that actually know their shit. You know, the people that know what a THACO is.
Sure. But, okay, the ones that you called out internet stars.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Stars.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody and their fucking brother and their sister has a podcast or a blog or a YouTube channel or fucking whatever. All of them. The ones that you called out are stars.
So you're saying
why do you think they're stars? The rules have not changed. The rules are the same as they've been since the beginning of fucking time, whether you're talking about musicians or movie stars or TV stars or YouTube stars. The attractive ones rise to the top almost every time. Coincidence? Probably fucking not, because we are, admit it or not, we're going to pay the more attention to the attractive people. Now, if you're in the nerd realm, you have to know your nerd shit, right? Because we're not going to, like, listen to tech news from somebody that doesn't even fucking understand anything about tech. So you got to know your nerd shit. But in this day, everybody's a fucking nerd. The pretty ones or the handsome ones, whatever, are going to rise to the top. And those are the ones that we're going to pay attention to. You know, no offense whatsoever to Veronica or Allie or anybody, but I'm sorry, part of your success is probably because you're not difficult to look at. This is not just sexist, because this goes with the guys,
so,
too.
So he was doing really good there.
Look at Jeff Cannata. Okay, let's turn this around. I don't want to make this seem misogynistic or sexist or whatever. But like, let's look at Jeff Cannata, for example. Do you? I know, Amos, you don't really care too much for Jeff Cannata, or at least not his shows. But Chris, do you watch it or listen to any of his stuff? Jeff Cannata, yes. He does
the We Have Concerns and all that. The We Have Concerns, sure. A podcast. Yeah.
But with Anthony Carboni, right. Yeah. But the point I'm trying to make is that Jeff Cannata is not an unattractive man, right? I mean, like, he's a, you know, a good looking guy. He's somebody that, like, as other dudes, we can look and say, like, you know, oh man, yeah, I'd like to be more like that guy, right?
Oh,
so you know what I'm saying? Like, it's the appearance thing makes it, it's part of the package of what you're presenting. And the easier you are to look at, it increases your chances of rising to the top.
So what you're saying, sense? What you're saying
am
is...
Am I pulling an Amos here and digging myself into a hole?
What you're saying is we should never release this video.
I think part of what you're saying makes sense, yeah, completely. But I think the larger part of it, for me, in my personal opinion, is, and you hit on it already, you both actually said it, is that if you know what you're kind of talking about and you can show that genuine, passionate interest in what you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
that's, everyone's going to feed on that.
Right,
I think
right.
a lot of people will feed on that. For me, I mean, for instance, for me, when I first saw Molly Wood on DTNS,
mm-hmm.
oh my gosh, like I fell in love with her, not based off looks or anything like that, because of her personality, her, like, the fire she brought to, like, the tech that she talked about and her mm-hmm. attitude towards it. I was like, I love Molly Wood. I freaking love her. Following her on Twitter right now, following all this. And then when I first heard Jeff Cannata and Anthony Carboni, and then I can say right now, I have not always agreed with everything that I've seen Jeff Cannata talk about on Twitter and all that. Not at all.
Agreed. Agreed.
However,
yep.
When Facebook, listened to them on when I listened to them on the We Have Concerns podcast, though, oh my gosh, those guys cracked me up. I even though I may not agree with like half the stuff that a lot of people that I've listened to that they say, their passion that they bring to their podcast, that they bring to what they talk about, mm-hmm. is what I thoroughly enjoy. Honest. And that's like why, like, I can probably count on probably one hand of all the people that I like to listen to. Yep, you guys are on there. Don't worry about it. You guys are there.
we both just naturally assumed we weren't.
I really could keep it because of the passion you guys bring to it. And I'm a man. I can say right now, on my manly side, you guys are not the hottest thing. You're not no Ryan Reynolds, okay? Neither am I. I'm not. Okay. I'm no Ryan Reynolds. I know it.
Yeah,
I admit it.
The record, you're like at least three steps closer than either me or Kent.
but the passion that you guys bring to the podcast, like even like when I listen to Tom or I listen to Jury or those guys, that they bring to what they talk about, it's the passion for me that draws me in. And like Veronica or Allie, their personality, their passion, like with Veronica and the way she can do anything. I mean, I swear, she can freaking do anything. The Ask Veronica, I love that. Or Dear Veronica. I love that. But it's just, I don't know. For me, it's the personality. For me, it really is honestly the personality. And that's what I enjoy. That's what I look for.
So why do you listen to this podcast then? Because we
we're ugly, we're stupid.
You do this and you say what's on your mind. I love it. That's what I'm all about right there. You say what's on, and that's what I love about it. I mean, like, yeah, I love it. I mean, that's so I don't look at the looks. For me, it's not the looks. You can be the ugliest son of a gun that you want to be.
Now, let me make it clear. I don't go searching out for people because of their aesthetics when it comes to tech news or geekiness or whatever else. Like that's, you know, for me, I'm mostly a podcast listener. That's primarily how I keep up with things and everything else. In fact, me watching DTNS live was a fluke. I just happened to not be able to sleep that morning and it came on. I was like, okay, well, I'll watch it. I was simply remarking that there is like I don't know, maybe because it's more accepted or because it's wider spread now, or if there's more eyes on it or whatever else. But
it's definitely more accepted. You're right.
It's not something it's not something that's shunned and made people ashamed of what they are or whatever else. So I think that just opens up a lot more of the, like you said, the personality, things like that. But when a person is accepted, they're more likely to play to the crowd and actually give a shit what they look like. And it becomes, that's not to say, oh, well, I don't fucking care, I'm just going to put everybody off to the side. When you know that you're accepted in a community or in a culture, it's easier to present yourself in a way that is more accepted in that community, in that culture. And I really think that that's a lot of the case. And, you know,
These cons. Nowadays, the cons that we go, that everybody talks about nowadays, Comic Con or Dragon Con or mm-hmm. any of these cons, it is so much more accepted nowadays. Think about when it was for like when we were younger.
Oh my god!
Did you guys hear about?
Like we heard about Gen Con. Like we were like, okay, Gen Con, so we can go there and play D&D. But that's in like Milwaukee shit.
Do not mention in public that you play Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah,
because you're gonna have the Christian right tell you that you're going straight to fucking hell. And then you've got everybody else that you know doesn't believe you're going to hell for playing it. Everybody else is like, wow, you fucking dork. Like, I thought you were okay until you said that. Fuck you.
Oh, man, fantasy sports. Sports hit big, dude, I was like, oh, this is like the fucking reckoning. This is amazing. Because now these damn jocks, these guys that had been worried about nothing but sports their entire time, all the guys that made fun of me for knowing how to do algebra, you know, they are now, and I'm not even talking like super difficult shit, trigonometry or whatever, calculus, all that shit, just algebra. They are now playing these games and making believe that they are a manager of this fake team, and they're crunching numbers and they're looking at stats and oh, you're playing fucking D&D.
Hey, yeah. There's kids on Twitch. There's young kids on Twitch that are making money on playing video games that we used to play as kids. Mm-hmm. And like we didn't have nobody like sitting around paying us money to watch us play Minecraft or something like that. You know, I mean, and like I was saying that today when I was at Pentacon, I went in line and there were some kids that was behind me. They were talking about how they just skipped school, you know, for the day and whatever. And they're all dressed up in their costumes. They're talking like one was dressed up. This one girl's dressed up as Harley Quinn, and the one guy was dressed up as I cannot think of the guy's name from this video game, Red Dead Revolver, I think.
Mm.
They were cosplaying as that, but they were like maybe 15, 16-ish, and it was just like so. I was like, you know what? I wish it was like that when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, I wish it was like that when I was a kid that you could be out here dressed up in your cosplaying, whatever that you wanted to be like, expressing yourself, however you wanted to express yourself. And it was widely accepted. And no one is going to judge you for it, make fun of you for it. I mean, they probably get made fun of, but like they're in an area that they can be openly accepted. And everyone's going to be like, I mean, seriously, people are like, hey, can I get a pic? Can I get a pic? Like everyone's want to take pictures with them. And
meanwhile, back in me and Kent's day, we tried to play Dungeons and Dragons during lunchtime and got soda sprayed on us. That's a literal story that actually happened. Like that's not something I'm just making up. Like we were sitting there trying to play D&D and we were just getting started, just broke the dice out, and one of the fucking jocks sitting over like three tables over did the little shake it with a can and pop the top with the pencil and. All over my fucking books and everything else. Like that actually happened.
That was probably me.
Truth.
Yeah. you went to high school in Indiana.
Yeah. So Amos, you were talking about the Dungeons and Dragons, or like jocks basically playing, quote Dungeons and Dragons now with like fantasy sports and all that kind of stuff. But I was kind of forced into playing fantasy football. With my girlfriend Stephanie's family, 2 years ago now, I guess, is when we started. So I haven't changed my name. My name, if you can see it,
D&D for jocks.
D&D for jocks. Yeah, that's what. Because I was protesting. I didn't want to play fantasy football, but I was kind of forced into it. I was like, all right, fine. If I'm gonna play, then I'm gonna.
That is cool.
Fuck it. I'm just gonna be me.
Yeah.
Because this is what I think about it. This is fucking D&D for jocks. And
that's why I like when people make fun of other guys for like playing WoW and all that. And that they talk about playing Call of Duty or playing Destiny. And I'm like, you understand it's that you're basically playing WoW right now. And
they're like, it's all the same shit. It's flavor. Yeah. It's like I like hamburgers, I like tacos. It's you both like food. Shut the fuck up. That's your preference. So
I love tacos more than hamburgers. I'm not gonna lie. I mean, I do.
Right.
But no, you're right. I mean, you're honestly right, though. I mean, that's what it's like. But Amos, going back to what you're saying, though, man. I mean, it really is. It is more widely accepted, and I think that also what Ken's saying that the looks, the aestheticness. I mean, the aesthetics of it is gonna maybe make more people want to watch that stuff more than others. I mean, it's. We're human beings. That's kind of just how we're built. We like to look at pretty stuff. Ooh, shiny object. Let me look at that. Ooh, there's something pretty over there. Let me look at that. I mean, we're humans. I mean, that's just one of our dumb faults that we have. We like to look at pretty stuff more than we like to look at ugly stuff. Flat out.
Yeah. Well, I mean honestly. Okay, if you got two personalities that you're going to choose between this personality and this personality, and they're basically the same, like they're both incredibly smart. They're both incredibly charismatic. They're both... like just great to listen to, but one of them is like really super pretty. I mean, which one are you going to choose to look at? Of course. I mean, that's just human. No, just like you said, I'm basically just saying exactly what you said, Chris.
Yeah. So we're all saying the same thing, I think.
So yeah, this is my thing here. And we'll go to something else after this, but if you're playing D&D and you're walking along and someone's got a charisma of 18 and you're staring at them, is that your fault?
I never played PvP.
I mean, if they have a charisma, they get a charisma of 18 and an intelligence of 17.
Well, depends on what you actually roll. No, you know? Like they rolled 18, or that's their attribute. Like
they have an attribute of 18. Like,
oh, okay.
You know what I mean?
Well, what's your attribute? I mean,
I don't know. Like if I was going to judge myself on charisma, 18, I mean, I'd give myself like a 10. I don't know, like something, you know, middle of the road.
No, I don't think it's your fault. It's
I'm going to go with a no.
Yeah, it's the universe.
Chris doesn't know what Thaco is. That's what's wrong.
I never played D&D.
Oh, you missed out.
I tried to play D&D.
But it cut into football practice, didn't it?
It sure did. It really did.
That and you didn't have a good DM.
That's I was friends with those guys. I mean, I was friends with like guys like you. I was friends with nerds like you. I was. I mean, I was friends with you nerds.
Oh, the blessings.
So, you people.
But I didn't feel like I honestly didn't have the imagination for it. I really didn't. I didn't have the because I didn't. I was trying to just jump in on it. Like I tried WoW one time. I tried it a couple times. I was horrible. I was seriously horrible at WoW. I mean, I was no kidding. I was so bad at it that the guy's profile that I was playing, like, honestly ripped the mouse out of my hand. It was like, dude, I'm losing too much gold from you. I'm like, because I was hitting his own teammates, and they got mad, and they started, like they took everything he had. And he was so mad because they were all like, why are you hitting me? What's going on? I was just trying to attack. I didn't know what was going on. So,
so you had a bad teacher.
Oh,
you jumped into the middle of something instead of starting from the beginning where you actually learn your ropes. All right. So earlier this week, I saw a tweet from Brian Brushwood who's responding to somebody thanking Brian Brushwood for introducing him to a certain article. And apparently this article has been around since like 2012. And I read the article and I don't want to say it spoke to me, but it actually made genuine sense. It really did. And essentially what it comes down to, it's called Six Harsh Truths That Will Make You a Better Person by David Wong. And I got to say, the first line, and it hooked me, and I had to read it from there. First line is, 2016, motherfuckers, yeah, let's do this. And I was like, all right, you got my attention.
Well, and the funny thing is, that's the least indicative thing about you could pick any line from that article and it's the least indicative of but it is a good hook.
So essentially what it comes down to is who you are doesn't matter to the world at large. You know, good on you for being a nice person, whatever. It's what can you do, what do you produce, what do you make, what are you giving the world tangibly? You know, your attitude is, yeah, you might make someone smile, but who gives a shit? Are you making them laugh? You know, are you providing a service to them to where they will actually pay you to make them laugh? Are you giving them a product that they will pay for? Are you doing something that will actually generate an income for you? Because being a nice person doesn't matter to the world at large.
Well, here's the thing. Like, I think you slightly missed Mark when you said you're making them smile, but are you making them laugh? It's more along the lines of I'm not being a dickhead to anyone. But are you making them smile or laugh?
Yeah.
You know, because, you know, it doesn't have to be a moneymaker, but it has to be a contributor. So if one of the examples that the author used over and over again was the pretty girl, like, why can't I get a girlfriend? Mm. You know, I'm a nice guy. You know, why do they always fall for these douchebags? Well, it's because you haven't advertised yourself. You have not shown her anything that. You know, makes you worthy of being her boyfriend. So if you're just sitting there admiring this girl and worshiping her and, oh, I'll do anything. I'll, you know, do you need help with that? Like, can I do something? Okay. You might have the heart of gold and all the intentions of the world, but why does she want to be with you? What are you doing for her? Like, are you making her laugh?
Are you listening, Chris?
You know, so I don't know.
Funny
that,
you
I
say
like,
that.
I like the analogy, but
funny
I really
you say
like,
that.
Have you read this?
No, So I read this. I mean, I really did read it.
he looked at the pictures.
There are a lot of Alec Baldwin video.
Yeah.
That
from Glengarry Glenn Ross. Yeah.
But I mean, to me though, I mean, you're hitting it right on the head though. I mean, it's like grab life by the balls and go. Don't just sit back and just, you know, expect it to happen for you. Like, what's going to come to me? Like, all right, yeah, I'm like you're saying, oh, I'm being a nice guy. I'm like this and that. If you cannot state, and I like what it says in there, if you cannot state right away five things about you that define you, then this article is for you.
Mm. Right. If you can't. And by defining you, it's not adjectives. It's not like, well, I'm nice, I'm honest. Yeah. You have to show proof. You have to show evidence. You have to state, I did this. I do this. Not I am. You have to show that here's my evidence, here's my proof.
And I really like that about it. And it's like Amos said, you're saying, I mean, it's a harsh reality. I mean, it really is a harsh look at yourself to go,
yeah,
dang, I can only name three. Or I can only name four. One short? Really? I'm only one short?
Or
you start reading through the rest of it.
Or you're looking at, and you're like my self-assessment was more like,
but I'm a nice guy.
Yeah. But see, I can't even say that because I'm kind of a dick.
Yeah. Like, shit, I'm not even a nice guy.
I live on the fact that I'm an asshole. I love it. Like, I feed on that at work. Like, if I could be an asshole to someone, I mean, like, it matters.
But
fact,
are you entertaining? Are you entertaining? Let me play something
for you that I walked into work the other day. All right, so the other day at work, I walked into work. I had my Bose speaker thing, Bluetooth Bose speaker, right? And I walked into this. I am a real American. Fight for the rights of
every man.
So I'm playing that, and so as I'm walking in, I just hold that open in the door, right? And I look in, and I can see them already there. Everybody's like, they're looking around like, what the hell? And I turn it louder on my phone. I go to the loud volume right when it hits, right? Like when it hits the ba-da-ba-ba-ba. So I make a show of it. I walk in, like I do the whole show, and then I get to my desk. I set the speaker down, and then I do the whole taking the shirt off. And I'm sitting there like, and it's going. And then I do the whole.
Yes.
Right. And then that's when it hit them. It hit everyone. They're like, oh, shit, yeah, there it is. Like, they knew what it was right then. I do that. I mean, like, I try to do that type of stuff. I try to bring that type, like, that type of stuff. But, like, people know, like, I had two of my inspectors the other day were like, hey, Sergeant Cabano, we saw this, you know, over here. You want to be an asshole to someone? I was like, well, when do I not want to?
Yes.
let's do this. So they told me what happened, and I got on Nerd Chat, which is, like, instant messenger for the military. So I get on Nerd Chat and I Nerd Chat this one guy. I'm like, hey man, some of my guys saw you doing this, or some of my inspectors saw you doing this. They're looking up the reference right now, and I'm sorry, man. It's a buddy of mine. As soon as they told me who it was, I was like, oh damn, this is gonna be fun. So I sent it to him. I'm like, hey, they're looking up the reference right now. I'm sorry, it's gonna be a fail against you guys, you know, this and that. And I left. Like I went for my computer. I thought I was only gonna be gone for like a few minutes. I ended up being gone for like an hour and a half for a meeting. And by the time I got back, my Nerd Chat was so full of, this is bullshit, blah, blah, this and that. Like, he was so fired up from it. And I was just like, oh, dang, I forgot to tell him I was joking. Dang, that sucks.
Oops.
But, you know, and I get a hold of him. And I tell him, hey, I'm joking.
Did he insult,
I say, hey, man. Well,
but did he insult your mom?
Longer. What's that?
Did he insult your mom?
No.
Oh, see? So it's not personal yet.
They know better. I'll
pound their fucking asses,
guys. But everybody, people at work know that I can be an asshole. They know I can be, but I like to mess around with people more than anything else, than just being a straight asshole. So like when this whole thing, when I read this article, I was like, the first thing I thought of was like, I make the best damn bulgogi that anyone's ever ate because everyone asked me to make bulgogi every freaking week. I'm always being asked to make the best bulgogi.
There's one
thing.
Right. So I was a beta tester for that bulgogi. I'll have you know.
Oh, yeah. Matter of fact, you were. And I've perfected my recipe, by the way. My recipe, that's another story. But so then I'm like, okay, number two. So then I'm like, number two. I immediately went to, I'm a nice guy and people like me. But then I was like, no, I know I'm a nice guy and people fucking like me, because dudes will come up to me and ask me, they'll ask me how to, like, hey, I have this genuine problem. How can I, like, can you help me get it fixed? And I go, I roll right back to my first sergeant days, and I help them back, you know? So I was like, yeah, I do help people out. I know people can come to me. And I was like, number three, what can I go with number three? And then I started, like, slowing down on, like, my stuff, and I was like, damn, I need to read this article. Yep. I was like, damn, I need to read this article. Because I could only, like, I got the three, and I was like, oh, maybe. But it's like you said, though, it was an adjective. It was really more of an adjective more than a real action that, like, I could really say that I do. And, yeah, so, I mean, it was a great article. I loved it. I was glad you posted it, and I was glad that Schwood retweeted it. And I can't remember who originally did it, but somebody commented back to him to say, hey, thanks for the article and all that. And I was so glad that I saw that, because it really did make a difference for me.
Yep. Yeah.
Especially with this girl that I've been talking with this week. Yeah, I mean.
So you've been doing more than being.
Yes, I've taken it to heart. I've taken this article to heart. I've taken it to heart.
That's awesome.
Cool, man. All right, so this is going to be another long show, just like last week with Bryce. Oh, my God. So
we're getting really good at going really long.
Oh, man, I just miss all the time. Man,
which is kind of what Cabo was talking about, I think. But sorry, out of context. All right, so, hey, Chris, where are you at on the internet, man? What are you doing? Where can people find more of you? Because obviously you're such a likable guy, and people are like, oh my God, I need more of him. Where can they find it?
I can tell you right now, my Twitter's probably if you want to hit me up on Twitter, you can. My Twitter is Cabo underscore Wabo 79.
And Facebook, Amos, you make fun of me having an underscore. RM underscore Del Noche. How about this motherfucker that's got an underscore and numbers?
Right, yeah, but his underscore separates words, so that's forgivable because it's actually there in place of a space. So,
he's just saying that
because and the 79 is just a designator because there's probably plenty of Cabo Wabos out there, but he had to say which one he is to designate which year he was born.
The freaking lick because of the tequila is what.
Yeah,
I didn't realize that was a tequila until I actually . I was like, why the hell can I not use Cabo Wabo for anything? This is getting stupid. Like, I don't get it. And then I found tequila. Who was it? Some rocker dude.
Sammy Hagar. No,
yeah,
not,
Sammy Hagar.
Is it Sammy Hagar or David Lee Roth?
It's Dry 55.
No, yeah, Sammy Hagar.
Yeah, it's one of those. Yep.
Yeah. But no, you can catch me at Cabo underscore Wabo 79. I try to stay active on there as much as possible. I've really been trying to be more active on social media than I have been in the past. Because, like, it's so much fun. It really is.
It's hard to pick up chicks when you're not out there, right?
Yeah, I know, right? I say you can find me on my Tinder profile, or my Plenty of Fish profile, but that's more the local area than it is anywhere else. Yeah. That's a whole nother show itself.
Stick around for the after show.
Yeah. And how about you, Kent? Where can people find you?
Well, I already called out my Twitter at RM underscore Del Noche, but if you're a beer guy like me and you want to know what I said about this beer right here, you can go to ratebeer.com and look up username Del Noche. That's about it.
Wow, that's pretty exciting. Like,
it's exciting to me.
It is?
Yeah, sometimes.
Yeah? No, I was talking about the beer. Is the beer exciting?
Beer is always exciting. Well, that's not true. That's actually not true.
Oh my God! So I'm going to be. I'm flying home on Tuesday, and sometime within about a week of that, I'm going to be able to drink some Left Hand Milk Stout from the tap, and it's going to be amazing.
Oh yes.
So
sounds so good.
All right, I can be found on Twitter at Ethan Kane. Don't even just accept it.
Yeah, just listen to the old shows. We're going to have one show that just explains.
Yeah.
Everything. Amos, that should have been episode 42.
Yeah.
The answer to life, the universe, and everything.
No shit. You can follow the show at Ritual Misery. And you can submit ideas at our subreddit, ritualmisery.reddit.com. You can email us, podcast at ritualmisery.com. Call and leave us a voicemail, 567-69-TRMPC. That's 567-698-7672. Of course, you can find all these links and more ways to support the show and give feedback at our website, ritualmisery.com. A special thank you to Kevin McLeod for allowing us to use your music. And thank you to you, fellow our listener, I was going to say fellow listener, for Kent, for me, and for you, and for Chris. This has been your Ritual Misery Podcast.
See ya.
Later.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.
Nice.
All right. Yeah. All right. Can't even figure it out. He's gonna be scissoring.
You're scissoring. You're a little scissoring action going on.
Hey, you know, that's not always bad.